Good morning to one and all. In continuation to the yesterday's session, we have discussed certain points related to the digestion. In the digestion process, we have discussed that carbohydrates, proteins, and fats are present. And digestion takes place in three different places. One is oral cavity, second one stomach, third one small intestine, and also in the duodenum, which is a part of small intestine. These two are belongs to the same. Oral cavity, 30% of digestion takes place. No protein digestion takes place. No fat digestion takes place. And when the food enters into the stomach, it stays for 4 to 5 hours because of the action of HSCL plus gastrointestinal intrinsic factor, which is also called as gastric juice, and pepsinogen produced by peptic cells or chief cells and mucosa. So mucosa protects walls. Mucosa protects the walls of the digestive system. Pepsinogen produced by the chief cells will be converted into pepsin by the action of HCl, and at the same time the bacterium or pathogens present in the food is died by HCl. And at the same time in the digestive tract, 1.8 pH is maintained in the stomach. From then onwards, when the food moves into the digestive tract, that is duodenum, then it is exposed to pancreatic juice and bile juice in the duodenum part. This pancreatic juice and bile juice will be having certain components like, so we will write the composition of the bile juice and pancreatic juice. Here bile juice consists of bile pigments, cholesterol, bile salts, and without no enzymes. This is the composition of bile juice. Coming on to the pancreatic juice. Pancreatic juice consists of trypsinogen, chymotrypsinogen, carboxypeptidases, lipases, amylases. These are the components present in the pancreatic juice. Apart from these, nucleases also are present. So when the bile juice, they are subjected to here carboxypeptidases, Present in the pancreatic juice iron like and trypsinogen and chymotrypsinogen. So they are changed to trypsin. So the trypsin and chymotrypsin acts on proteins and converts the proteins into peptones and peptides. Peptides. And at the same time, in the duodenum, bile juice acts on the fat and converts the fat into emulsified fat. Emulsified fat. This emulsified fat and the proteins and carbohydrates now move into the small intestine. So already we know that when the food is in the mouth or oral cavity, it is called as bolus. And when it enters the bolus into the stomach, it is called as chyle. And when it enters from the stomach into the small intestine, it is called chyle. It is called as chyle. So here the emulsification of fat is the small intestine now further absorbs the food. Absorbs the food. So once again I am repeating, please try to understand. So we know that there are three macro major molecules. One is called as carbohydrates, proteins and fats. So these are all present in the food and they are first mixed up with the saliva, then it is chewed, churned, mixed and rotated, and it is made into a ball like structure called as bolus. The bolus from the mouth enters into the esophagus and comes to the stomach through maintained by the gastroesophageal sphincter, that is called as food enters into the stomach, it is subjected to gastric juices. These gastric juices consist of HCl, castor intrinsic factor, and also the other pepsinogen. Pepsinogen is the inactive form, means not active. Once it is subjected to that, so partial protein digestion starts in the stomach because pepsinogen is Pepsi, and now it starts acting on the proteins, and the proteins are complex proteins are converted. So the protein digestion starts in the stomach, the starch digestion or the carbohydrate digestion has already started in the stomach, and when coming into the, so other partial dissociation takes place, and once the partial dissociation, at the same time the fats will not be digested in the stomach. Now the fats will move into the duodenum through the pyrolic sphincter, and when it is moving to the pyrolic sphincter, the pancreatic juice from the pancreas and the bile juice from the bile duct comes and combines with the food. Now it is called, from now onwards the food is called chyle. Now further, when it moves into the jejunum or ileum, it is converted into chylomicrons, the smallest observable forms, and they are absorbed by the respective villi or microvilli present in the small intestine. Now we will see the fate of the three components. Carbohydrates The complex form of carbohydrates is starch. Starch. The starch by the use of salivary amylase. Saliva consists of salivary amylase that is converted into maltose. Maltose. Maltose is a disaccharide. Disaccharide. Maltose is a disaccharide. So here the next step, when you talk about only the digestion process in the small, large intestine or small intestine, now this is in the mouth, and from the mouth, after converting into maltose, it comes into the stomach, and from stomach it moves into the duodenum, and when in duodenum, when it is subjected to digestion process, the maltose present, maltose is converted to glucose plus glucose. The maltose will be converted to glucose plus glucose with the help of an enzyme which is present in the pancreatic juice called as amylase. So that is, the enzyme is maltase. Ase means enzyme. Glucose plus glucose. And lactose in the duodenum or the small intestine converted into glucose plus galactose. Glucose plus galactose by the help of enzyme lactase. By the help of the enzyme lactase. And sucrase is converted to glucose plus fructose with the help of enzyme sucrase. So these three steps of carbohydrate digestion takes place in the duodenum and also in the jejunum of small intestine. This is because of these juices are from pancreatic juices. So first part in the mouth, second part in the duodenum and jejunum, the digestion of carbohydrates takes place. Now, proteins directly move into, means without digestion they move into stomach, and they are subjected to HCl. From stomach they move into the small intestine. So the proteins are first converted into peptides or peptones, and these are finally converted to dipeptides with the help of enzyme trypsin or chymotrypsin. So this happens from the stomach to the small intestine. Once they are converted into dipeptides, these will be converted into these dipeptides after with the help of carboxypeptidases, that is dipeptidases. They are converted into amino acids with the help of enzyme called dipeptidases. Dipeptidases are converted to amino acids, means proteins in the stomach when subjected to and enters into the small intestine. These proteins are converted to peptides. Peptides or peptones are proteases. With the help of action of these will be converted to trypsin. With the help of trypsin and chymotrypsin, they are converted to dipeptidases. These dipeptidases are converted to amino acids by the action of dipeptidases. Once the food enters into the, now we are talking about the fat digestion. Fat digestion. So fats when enter into the duodenum, it is first subjected to bile juice acts on this and converts the fat into emulsified fats. This emulsified fats will be subjected by lipases. Lipases acts on the food. Lipases acts on the food, and this lipases converts the fats into diglycerides. Diglycerides plus glycerol. Diglycerides plus and this diglycerides by the action of lipase are converted to monoglycerides, and these are monoglycerides are absorbed as chylomicrons. Chylomicrons. So the amino acids at the same time, the amino acids of protein which contains the nucleic acids, by the help of nucleosidases are converted into nucleosides, thus they are absorbed into the blood. Willy absorbs them and sends them to the blood. So here one point I need to say you, that small intestine consists of a specific type of cells called as goblet cells. These goblet cells produces mucus, and there are one more type of cells called as brush border cells. These brush border cells produce intestinal juices like nucleotidases, nucleosidases, lipases, carboxyamylases. So these are These fresh water cells produce intestinal juice. So these mucus and intestinal juice combinedly called as intestinases are Succus Entericus. So the Succus Entericus generally consists of ghrelin and leptin also. So this is the Succus Entericus is also called as the second brain of body. Second brain of body because the complete digestive related activities is taken care by the Succus Entericus. Sometimes in our body when you see that certain sounds are produced, that sounds are also because of this, the production of these hormones in the body. So it is completely based on the body relevant activity. So I hope you have clearly understood these points. Now we'll start with the large intestine. Clear? So in the large intestine is having three parts, that is cecum, colon, rectum and anus. This colon again divided into three parts, that is upper going colon called as ascending colon, lower coming colon called as descending colon, and middle this part the transverse colon. So the small intestine part ileum is connected to cecum and forms a wall in between these two called ileocecal wall. So what does this do? This ileocecal wall prevents backward flow, that is movement of backward, it is prevented, backward flow of undigested food. So that is a major function. And here in the large intestine, no digestion a place, then what happens here? Only storage. And the large intestine is also responsible for absorption of water. So these are the functions that takes place in the large intestine. So it prevents the backward flow of undigested food is controlled by the ileocecal wall, and it also prevents the no digestion takes place in this. No digestive enzymes are present, storage, and the complete digestion takes place only in the small intestine. Small intestine is considered to be the most important part of digestive tract. All are important, but that is because more functions. So whatever the food present, the bolus is 30% digested food, and the chyme is 60% digested food. Chyme is 80% digested food, and the chyme when reaches in the ileum, it is 99.99% completely digested food. Once it enters into the large intestine, so the chapter of the digestion process is closed. So in all this, the pancreatic juice, generally maintains alkaline nature, which is essential for the digestion to be completed, because at a acidic pH some digestion takes place, and at alkaline pH some digestion takes place. Generally 8 pH is maintained in the body in the small intestine. Coming on to the next one, absorption. So absorption in the small intestine, so absorption takes place in the complete small intestine with the help of microvilli and supporting villi, where the lactate takes this and sends to the blood. So we have three types of absorption methods. One is called as facilitated transport, facilitated diffusion, simple diffusion. So this absorption process is of three types: active, passive, and facilitated. Active absorption is of three types: active and passive and facilitated. What is the meaning of that? Active means with the involvement of energy. Passive, without involvement of energy. Facilitated, with the help of a particular protein. With the help of a particular protein, this transportation takes place. So, in these are again three types. So, simple diffusion, simple diffusion means without, by passive and active simple diffusion, certain components are transported, absorbed. So what are those? Remember the word K. So C stands for the chloride ions, A stands for the amino acids, G stands for the glucose molecule stands for the electrolytes like HCO3 minus K plus Cl minus Na plus. So the simple diffusion takes place in the small intestine, and the elements which are done by simple diffusion is chloride minus ions, amino acids, glucose and electrolytes. Next, facilitated diffusion. Facilitated diffusion. So in this FAN, fan, remember the word that fan, that is fructose amino acids, certain amino acids and sodium plus ions will be transported to this facilitated diffusion, facilitated. And the last one next, active diffusion. This active diffusion takes by, please remember the word, N-gain. N-gain, that is sodium plus ions, glucose, amino acids, monoglycerides and electrolytes transported through this process such a way, and fat is not absorbed into blood. So they will be floating in the blood or they will be attaching to the tissues. So you try to understand that absorption takes place by three methods. One is active method, that is with the involvement of energy, passive method without involvement of energy, facilitated with the help of a particular protein and energy requirement. So what is that simple is passive: chloride ions, amino acids, glucose, electrolytes like bicarbonates, potassium ions, chloride ions and sodium ions. Now facilitated diffusion, with the help of a carrier protein, if they are transported, they are called, that is called facilitated transmission diffusion, that is fructose, amino acids and sodium plus ions. And for active diffusion, sodium plus ions, glucose, amino acids, monoglycerides and electrolytes are absorbed, and in the process of absorption, fat is not from the blood. As a result of this, you can see that the complete absorption is completed in the small intestine, and that leads to the energy generation through respiration process.